Hello everyone. Today we are going to try to understand ATP. Let's start. Now, the first time you hear about ATP is it being called the energy currency. So let us first talk about energy. How do you store energy? Energy on Earth is available from the sun, and the sun gives energy which is available as light. But how do you store that energy? You use it to form chemical bonds. You use it to energize electrons and form bonds. What does that mean? Now, imagine two of your classmates who do not want to sit together. Now, what does your teacher do? Your teacher says, if you sit together, you can get a chocolate. What is this chocolate in our terms? It is energy. So, energy can bring atoms together and keep them together in a chemical bond that we now call molecules. Plants or other bacteria that can capture the energy of light do exactly that. They capture light energy and store it in big molecules called carbohydrates. Even methane, which has a lot of CH bonds, can store this. But for us, it is carbohydrates, a molecule which has a lot of CH and COH bonds. So now the storage part is complete. But how do you use this energy? A very common misunderstanding is that you can just break these bonds to get energy. But remember, no one likes to give away the chocolates. So in order to get them to release the energy, you have to invest some energy so that they can be broken. So you first need to invest some energy to pull out that chocolate so that you can have a net release of energy. So you can always get energy by breaking these compounds, but you will always be focused on a net release. Why a net release? Because you will eventually or initially invest some energy to break these. Now, why don't we use glucose for all purposes of our cells? Simply because it's too much. We've all seen a dam. What is a dam? It stores a lot of water, but what were to happen if a dam breaks? A large amount of energy would be released with the water, and it would wreak havoc. And that is exactly what would happen if the entire amount of energy of the glucose, which is 686 kilocalories per molecule, were released in a single step. So what do? The same thing that we do with dams. We release the water gradually in small pockets, and then you make electricity. In the same way, you can't use all the glucose now, and it's too risky. So you use glucose to create energy, to store energy in smaller packets that you call ATP, adenosine triphosphate. And then you break this ATP, adenosine triphosphate, three phosphates, with the help of water hydrolysis, always with water. Lysis means breaking. Hydro means in presence of water. You are breaking this, and you are pulling one phosphate apart, and that is one thing that is causing the net release of 7.3 kilocalories per mole. In most textbooks, you will see a minus sign in front, because we want to signify the amount of energy that is released. So, let us see the structure of ATP, just to make things clear for us. So, ATP has sugar, a base, and three phosphates. So the first is adenine, which is a base, and the second is ribose, a sugar. Combined, you call these adenosine. Adenosine is adenine plus sugar ribose. And then you have three phosphates. So when you break these bonds, if you just break the last bond, you will have ADP plus phosphate and a release of 7.3 kilocalories per mole. Remember, one mole has 6.0322 into 10 to the power of 23 molecules. So, adenosine triphosphate breaks, and you have two possible ways to use that. For the first one, imagine you have a plasma membrane. And in that plasma membrane, you have a protein channel, So this is a protein channel that can allow something to go from one side to another, or it can pull something from one side to another. The problem is something that needs to be pulled and is simply not fitting. Let's say it's sodium, for example. The release of this energy from hydrolysis of ATP can cause conformational changes of the protein that we're talking about, and the sodium is allowed to be passed. The release of this energy from hydrolysis of ATP can cause conformational changes of this protein that we're talking about, and the sodium's allowed to be passed. So that's the direct release of energy and use of this direct energy release to cause conformational changes. The other way is coupling. What is coupling? Let's try to understand that. So I want to convert glutamic acid to glutamine. Now, glutamine conversion requires it to combine with NH3. Alas, this reaction requires plus 3.4 kilocalories per mole. So what I do is I use my ATP. I break ATP, so when I break my ATP, that's going to give me ADP plus phosphate plus energy. And how much? I hope you remember, 7.3. I'm going to add a minus 7.3, so you remember it's going to be a release. This phosphate now binds to this glutamic acid. So remember, what was our goal? Our goal was to produce this reaction. That was your goal. So now I'm going to use this phosphate to phosphorylate this glutamic acid. So this glute is going to be phosphorylated for phosphorylated glutamic or glutamic acid. This is phosphorylated intermediate. Now you may ask, what is the big deal about phosphorylation? The big deal is you have added a bond, and a bond means energy. I've increased the energy of the glutamate system. Now this phosphorylated glutamate intermediate reacts with NH3 to give you finally glutamine and phosphate. So did you get what you wanted? Yes, you have glutamine. And did you get the energy that you need? Yes, you wanted 3.4 kilocalories per mole, and that was available in the form of phosphorylation. But where's the remainder? So you wanted 3.4, and you were given 7.3. If you do the math, you will have a total of 3.9 difference. This is the energy that will be released. Any reactions will continue to take place as long as there is a net reduction in the energy of the system. So this 3.9 is given out, and now the net energy content of the system is less because the 3.9 has been released. This is how you use coupling to drive one reaction that requires energy and another that gives off energy. In this case, that was the breaking or hydrolysis of ATP. Let's summarize. Adenosine triphosphate can act as energy currency because of hydrolysis reaction. You can use hydrolysis reaction in two ways: directly, like by causing a conformational change, or by coupling with another reaction. Thank you.
Can't find a biology topic you're struggling with? Let us know in the comments section and subscribe to check out new videos.